Thank you. I was driving on a country road early one morning when I came upon a doe who looked to have just been hit by a car. Her body was half slumped in the road, half in the dirt shoulder, her back legs kicking frantically like a dog running in a dream. I pulled up onto the dirt shoulder and I looked out through the window at her sprawled there, dying. I got out of the car and I approached her slowly, unsure and afraid. My mother was diagnosed with breast cancer and she asked for me, not for anyone else in my family. Maybe it was because she knew she couldn't ask them. She was too scared, or they were too scared for her. Or maybe because they were not her daughter. The letter I received, it read, "I cherish each moment with you, knowing you will be gone from my life someday. The closer that day comes, the more intense is the feeling. Add to that the bitterness and anger I feel toward this disease." It's a heartfelt letter from a hardworking single mother who taught me how to love unconditionally. She was scared. She couldn't breathe. She couldn't even eat or sleep until she talked to me, until she asked me. Her breathing labored, panic in her eyes, blood pouring and pooling from her mouth. I thought about a story I'd read or a movie I'd seen where a hero bravely ends another's suffering in some trying but ultimately righteous moment. I was also mourning the loss of her, you see. The disease that she's referring to in this letter is my husband, who I've been married to for 25 years and counting. The letter continues. "It will not get better, only worse. I can't change the way I feel, but you can. Please end this now. It's not that I don't believe you're in love. It's just that I know you can find someone else of your own race to love just as much, if not more. I beg you, end this now." I was the only person by her side day and night for 3 weeks after her surgery. I was the person who fed her and dressed her, who cleaned her enormous wound, the space where her breast used to occupy. I was her personal chef, her mental strength, her physical therapist, everything. So I walked back to the car to find something that could help in this grim endeavor, and I popped the trunk, and in the spare tire there was a tire iron and an old beach towel from who knows when, so I scooped up both and I ran back to her. A car whizzed by and I felt like a hero and a criminal all at the same time, but they didn't even stop to notice me. I knelt beside her head, carefully avoiding her back legs, and when she saw me, she fought with all of her strength to get up, to run, but she couldn't move. She was stuck, as if trapped in a net. Needless to say, I did not end it. I married him. But it was 1990, and I wasn't sure if my family would ever accept it. The covert catalyst for my mom, I believe, was the moment she realized that I was not budging, that she would truly have to live as if I were dead. And that scared her. More than having a black man in our family, more than the small southern town looking down on a woman whose daughter did such a horrible thing. I laid the towel over her head, and I watched. And in that moment, with the tire iron in my hand, I knew I wouldn't do it. I wasn't that brave, that humane, that selfless. I wouldn't become those things on the roadside this morning. And so, I left her there. I walked back to the car and tossed the bloody towel of tire iron onto the passenger seat. And eyes welling with tears, I started the car and drove away. Later that day, I drove by her again when I was coming back from where I'd been. And as I passed, I saw vultures tearing at her, tendrils of red and black, tug of war with cinnamon skin. They lazily bounced off the far side of her as I passed, but in that moment, they didn't leave her. They stayed. And I was so happy. And so she lived. My mom's living, and I left. And I said, fuck it. It was quick and covert, and I did it. And I kept living my life knowing that it needed to be filled, that I needed to do the filling after so much emptying and giving of myself. And that if I was going to fly, I would have to accept the fragility and the beauty of everything in life and fly in spite of it all.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
That if I was going to fly, I would have to accept it.